Yeah, I was thinking. I remember when I first became a bishop, and I can remember going places and having people get up and teach and do different things, and then someone would ask me to get up and pray. Someone would ask me to get up and say something. And fear would just grip me solid. Still Debbie's line mark in my pants. I was worried about it. She was, but it was like you know, because even though inside of me, and I believe this is true of every single Christian, inside of us there's a desire to do things that the spirit man is willing. The flesh isn't able to cross it sometimes. You know what I like about this place? In this place, there are people that no longer have that fear. I could probably get up here any given Sunday and say, you know what, I'm not preaching today. You are. I'm not going to do that today. Why? Because everyone here is so full. I mean, look at Rob Polk. And I love to hear him tell the story of his first day in church. And I remember that first day in church probably as vividly as he does. And I don't know what came over me that day. But you know what happened? When you look at it today, you look at Rob Westbrook, who doesn't like this, but he was sitting there. If I just said, you're preaching, he'd say, well, if I just send that chair out and do it, he'd probably do it. Why? Because there's a... And the thing is that we are equipping ourselves here to do the work of the ministry, and that's what it's about. It's not just about Deborah, I, or Pastor Joe, or Pastor Aaron, or Pastor Deb, whoever coming up here and preaching. It's about all of us equipping ourselves to do the work of the ministry, to branching out further, to going deeper than where you're at. We can get to a level of comfort in our own ministry that we won't go any farther. Well, I'm called to do this. Yeah, you're called to do that along with this, along with that. And the more branched out you get, the more you expand your horizons, the more God gifts you in those horizons. And otherwise, we become very comfortable. You know, we're in this series on 50 days, and just about the time I think, well, God, there's just nothing left to give an analogy. I mean, pop something else in my brain about the military. And, you know, there's a line, and to start with this, I want to change it up a little bit. I used the line a couple weeks ago. It was Mel Gibson's movie, Braveheart, says, about to die, says, every man dies, but not every man lives. But you know what? Yeah, this Trevor of Proverbs, our launching verse, and I was looking at that verse when we were worshiping, and God gave me this. He said, the verse says this, the fruit of the righteous is a tree of life, and he who wins souls is wise. And God says everybody lives. Everybody that's breathing right now is alive. Even those that are dead were once living. Am I correct? And so it's like, but to really live is to live a life of righteousness. Because in that life of righteousness is, well, according to this word, righteousness is the tree of life. It is the thing that takes us to levels we can never go before. It takes us into areas that only... You know, that only is allowed by the Holy Spirit working through us. You know, in just 50 days, things have changed for the disciples. And I got to thinking about basic training again, and I remember when I arrived during that first week of basic training. You know, they don't tell you this, but there's a reception. We planned our wedding around when we knew basic training would be done. Well, we were off by a week because they didn't tell you there's an additional week in the beginning that they call reception time. They want to make you feel at home in the Army. They want to make you feel at home in this reception time. And I can remember calling home, and it's like it was last night, standing in that phone booth in the reception area, and the night stars, and the Louisiana night, and everything like that. And I am man enough to tell you, I stood at that payphone as I talked to Debbie and cried like a baby. And I wanted to say, I made a mistake, can I go home? said, I didn't know how hard it would be away like that. I didn't know how hard it would be away from her and my family. I mean, it's like, and I remember thinking that. It's like, there was, during that first week, things changed, you know. It was in the early 70s, so we dressed funny, except for when Jenny and Bree, they dressed just like us today. And this one here, she thinks she is a hippie. But the guys there, they had shoulder length hair, hair longer than that, had some semi-beards or at least mustaches and stuff. And so one of the first things they do is they take you through, and the first night they come in, they bring you in the middle of the night. And they drop you off in somewhere that you don't know where you're at. It's not even an airport. They just find a landing zone, they drop you off, and you sit out there on top of what you thought you needed for life. And you're waiting. Finally, a bus picks you up. And the first thing you hear is off that bus comes this loud-mouthed guy with a really weird hat. Smoking bear hat. And he's yelling and screaming. You don't even know the guy. He's yelling and screaming at you. So then we get into the reception area, and all of a sudden, there's three more guys jump on this bus with you. They're yelling, get out, you jump. But one of the biggest things that happens after about a day or so is they decide that you have too much hair. And so they take you in, and they have this little barbershop where there's like three or four barbers lined up, and they got you all sitting out on these bleachers, and one after one, you go in, and the first thing the barber, you sit down, and the barber throws this tape over you, and he says, what would you like, how would you like it cut? Well, just take a little off the sides, back, it's not too bad, this, that type of thing. You come out, you're bald. Well, not totally bald, you got stubs. But there was guys come out, they had shoulder length hair. There was people coming out of there that you didn't recognize anymore after just 3 days because they didn't look the same anymore. There was something different about their appearance. There was something totally radically changed. You know, another thing that happened during that basic time is you learned a singular voice. Now there were drill sergeants in a platoon, and I'll explain a platoon in a minute. In a company, I should say, a company area. There was four platoons in a company area. And so it's basic training company, and there's four platoons, so there's four barracks. So each barracks, each platoon had at least two drill sergeants. So they would come out of the morning, and they would start yelling, and they'd come in, and we call it O-Dark 30. That's time Debbie gets me up now, is O-Dark 30. But it's like we get out there, and they're jumping, and you didn't want to listen to the drill sergeant in that platoon. You didn't want to listen to the drill sergeant in that platoon. You wanted to hear your senior drill sergeant, and so you learned his voice. And it's very important to hear that singular voice. It's very important to hear that voice of your leader and understand that voice, because he's the one that is going to lead you in the right direction. If you get listening to other people, you're going to get confused when it comes to the needs. And so you learn how to focus on one voice and one voice alone. I also learned how to utilize my time. I learned how to utilize my time when we would have, because the Army, I don't know about Joe was in the Navy, I don't know about that. I know that I don't have any other one. I think everybody else in the Army is a veteran here, but in the Army we called what we call hurry up and wait. In other words, they got you somewhere rapidly and then you sit for like an hour and a half while the drill sergeant had coffee and you're out there in the hot sun. But you're sitting out there, and so I learned you couldn't carry anything in your pockets, but you learned rapidly to carry things within your shirt area, and so I had a pen and paper always. Always. Sorry. And it's like, my mom tells stories that when I was like three, I'd have a pen and paper stuck, a pencil and paper stuck up under my arm like that, walk around the house. I didn't know how to write yet, but I had to have the paper pen, paper pencil. So anyway, I had these little notepads that were spiral notepads. You've seen them, the spiral at the top. And so when we were in downtime, which was, you know, you sit there, and so I'd write Debbie a letter. I'd start writing my letter to Debbie then. I'd just start writing my thoughts. Because it was like I was talking to her now. It was like I wasn't just sitting there. Some of the guys just nod off for a little. We had one guy could nod off at attention. He was at that. But it's like, I'd be writing all these notes. And so you learn to utilize your time in so many ways. All of the time that I was there. So the disciples, what one of the main things that the military tries to do during that basic training is to get you to quit. They want you to quit. They want the quitters out. They want them gone because they don't want a quitter in their battalion or in their company or in their squad when it comes to combat time. So they do their best to get you to quit. Even that guy I told you about a couple of weeks ago, I finally remembered his name. His last name was Emery.
I can't tell you what his first, Steve. It was Steve Emery. That's what it was. And it's like, but we all called him Charlie Brown. Now, they tried to get this guy to quit. And he needed to quit. But he wasn't about to quit until he got it out his way, okay? But so they tried to get you to quit. Well, what happens if we start looking at, turn with me over to John chapter 6. And so we look at John chapter 6, and what Jesus does here is he preaches a sermon to try to separate, if I may, ladies, the boys from the men, the ladies from the women from the girls. So he tries to preach a sermon that does that. And so in John chapter 6, let's look at verse, let's start at 53. Says this, and then Jesus said to them, "Most assuredly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink His blood, you have no life in you." Wait a minute. Can you see the reaction of the people? Like, what did he just say? Hey, so the wife's going, "Hey, what did he say, Sam?" So he goes on and says, "Whoever eats my," so he clarifies now, "whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life. And I'll rise up in him, raise him up in the last day." Now wait a minute. What he's trying to do is bring a point across about the need to be centrally on him, focusing on him. But he's also trying to get the people that don't want to be there gone. That don't need to be there, that are not willing to do what they need to do, not willing to sacrifice what needs to be sacrificed. So he goes on, and he goes on in that story and says this. He says, "And my flesh is food indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him. As the living Father sent me, I live because of the Father. So he who feeds on me will live because of me. This is the bread which has come down from heaven, not as your fathers ate the manna and are dead. He who eats of this bread will live forever." So he is correlating himself to something that Jews knew about historically. They didn't at this point in time. None of them had lived at that point in time when they made the exodus. And he drops on down just a little bit. Let's drop on down to verse 66 instead of reading all the way through that. Well, actually, let's do 61 because I sort of keys in where it said, "When Jesus knew himself that his disciples complained about this, he said to them, 'Does this offend you?'" We talked about offensive foundations things. Because offensive is a deal breaker for you. You can't get offended. So anyway, drops on down to verse 66. "From that time, many of his disciples went back and walked with him no more. And Jesus said to the 12, 'Do you also want to go away?'" Are you ready to quit? In the military, they try to get you to quit. They want to separate the boys from the men. They want you to quit, if you will, if you can. The disciples had gone through all of this, and they weren't budging. This is something you have to say. They didn't get offended. What they did is they got hungry. They got hungry for more of what he's teaching. They got hungry for more of this stuff that he's talking about. They got hungry. They didn't let offense in, and they chose not to get offended. In the military, there is different breakouts. I don't know how many of you, this is Army, so I'm not sure. I think it's different, obviously different in the Navy. But in the Army, there is the highest level of grouping is brigade level. At brigade level, that can have several battalions in it, okay? Battalion is the next one. In a battalion, there are companies, and I think, if I remember correctly, is there probably only about five or six companies within a battalion. And in a battalion, I mean, in a company, then there's platoons. Now, usually in a company, there can be anywhere from 4 to 5 platoons, depending on the size of the company. And again, and then within the platoon, there are what's called squads. And so then when you would line up in platoon formation, you would line up in your squads. So you have squad 1, 2, 3, 4. And each squad has a leader. And so each squad has a leader. And in that leader, he's next in line to the platoon sergeant. Okay. And the platoon sergeant is next in line to the sergeant major of the company. Okay, and in enlisted ranks. So in the squad, though, you hear about this all the time. You hear about the Navy SEALs and all them. That's a squad level. okay? They have a squad, and they're very versatile, they're very compact, and they work as a mechanized machine. Your squad, each of you had a role in your squad. Each of you had a place that you fit, that you had a purpose, and that you had a function. Thank you. And if you didn't do your part, this whole squad got messed up. And that would be the same all the way up the chain, all the way up. Each company had its purpose. In a battalion, there could be a mechanized infantry now. There could be a battalion. There could be ground forces. There could be administrative. There could be transportation. And all those different companies are in a battalion, okay? And so that they all function to help make that battalion work at its utmost in combat. Now, battalions were the same way. There were certain ones. Battalion this, that, and so each one had its function. The most powerful force, as I said, though, is in the squad. Turn me over to Hebrews chapter 3. The most powerful force is in that squad. So what we would be here, to be real honest, it's bigger, it seems like a bigger number, but we're a squad. We're a squad. And we learn to function as a squad. We learn to function in this place as each of us have a role. Each of us have a purpose. Each of us have a giftedness, as we put it in here. And so each of us operating that squad level position, you know, and within this place, then I would be the squad leader. Then you have assistant squad leaders or whatever. And so you would have that level. So we have the associates, their assistant squad leaders. But that does not diminish the new recruit that just got assigned to the squad. He still has a role. He still has a purpose. The squad's functioning correctly requires that person to work at their highest level to find their place, okay? And just because you have a leader over here, and what it does, anybody know who Audie Murphy was? Anybody? Audie Murphy was the most decorated soldier in World War II. He then became an actor and played in his own life story of how he got. He started out, I think, when he got to combat, he was a private or a corporal by the time he got to Europe. Something happened, he started excelling, he got promoted, field promoted to sergeant, just jumping over other people in ranks because he was stepping up doing what he knew. Then the next thing you know, the lieutenant, who is the platoon leader, he gets killed, and all of a sudden they give him a battle grade commission. In other words, he didn't go to school for it. They just said, you're qualified, you're now the lieutenant, now you run this squad. And so all the way, and so he became the most decorated warrior in World War II. And if you want to look him up, his grave at Arlington is still, people still come and put things on his tombstone. And he's been dead since the 60s, and the only thing you can do is read him. But he was a true hero. And so he started out over here in the squad. But because he kept moving, kept pressing in to the inside, that was the stuff that was already in him to be a leader, he kept moving up the ranks and he kept moving into a position where he could be used at his fullest. See, God wants you and I used at our fullest. He does not want us over here sitting down and saying, well, this is my function, I dig the latrine holes. Anybody know what a latrine is? For those of you that don't know what a latrine is, is you go out, you take this little shovel about this big, and you dig a hole, and you dig a hole. And if you're really lucky, you get to put like a tent around it, but not necessarily. And that latrine hole is where the whole squad goes to the bathroom when they need to go. Squatting over a hole in the ground. Now, then you have to go out, and because when that gets to where no more, you take the dirt, put it back on top of it, and you dig another hole. Okay? So you might be the guy. And usually the guy that has to do that is the one that got in trouble last. Okay? But you might be that guy. So, well, I'm just a latrine hole digger and I don't need it. I'm good. I do my thing. I do my job well. Everybody's happy with my hole that I dig. But that guy's value to the unit is important. But he also needs to realize that he needs to, or she needs to, keep moving into all the giftedness. Because that guy was trained just like all the rest. When I was in Vietnam, I was trained in the Marine. But I went to Vietnam, I was the distribution mail clerk. Now, that's no glory job. You're not going to get any awards. You're not going to get a Purple Heart. Well, unless you hurt yourself and you take it in and say, well, I got an amateur disciple, okay? I knew guys cut themselves shaving and get a Purple Heart. Why? Well, the bombs went off when I was shaving and cut myself. You're not going to get a Bronze Star, although I was put in for a Bronze Star because I was friends with the awards clerk. He tried to give me one at the end of the war, but I didn't get one, which I'm glad I didn't because it would have been a real cheap one. But my job, what I did, was just as valuable as the guy out tuning up the helicopters, getting them ready. And I did the best to do my job thoroughly because it functioned, everything made up. Because I brought the mail to the guys. I brought the letters home from home that said, hey, I love you, or hey, I'm getting divorced.
A few of those come across the lines too.
Things like this. So it's like, so you do this. But I wanted to do more. Rob is a better illustration, to be honest with you, this whole thing. And since he's not in here, I thought. Rob, his approach to life is in your face. Would anybody agree with me on that? He's right there. Now, not being mean. He knows this. When he was a little guy, he broke through the wall. Why did that wall is his way? I don't know why. He expected it to move. Am I right? He has never changed. So he got in the military, and I talked him into becoming a legal clerk, because that's the best job in the military. You have to score very, very high to get that job. But the bad part was, it's a 5-year enlistment. That's my minimum. You have to have 5 years. And so we started to get out, and my cousin was a recruiter. He said, no, you want to change that MLS? I said, no. Okay. So Rob gets to Fort Drum, New York, and he's in 10th Mountain Division, which is one of the most glorious divisions in the Army as far as combat. Now Rob's inner person, who he wants to be, Rambo, comes out. He's supposed to be told to retire, but Rambo comes out. Okay? We've got a picture of him at home from Haiti, when he's in Haiti, with his I'm going to war Haiti, and he's over there. He's got the ammunition belts draped across him like that. He's got the M16 on this. He's shirtless the whole thing. And he's Rambo, okay? And it's like, but see, he aspired greater than just being, he could have said, well, I'm just a legal clerk, you know, I don't need to do it. But Rob didn't want to do that. He wanted to push in. Well, the disciples, when we look at this, did we read Hebrews yet? We have Hebrews chapter 3 says this. We're going to look at verse 7, 8, and then verse 15. In order to step out, to do more, you've got to hear that voice. Remember I told you about hearing that voice, that singular voice? He goes out and says, and verse 7 and 8 says this. It says, therefore, says the Holy Spirit, today, if you hear his voice and not harden your heart, do not harden your heart as in rebellion and in the day of trial of the wilderness. It goes over, just drop over to the same chapter, verse 15, because he repeats it. He says, and while it is said today, if you will hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion. And then again in chapter 4, verse 7, it's repeated again. It says this, and again he designates a certain day, saying in David, today, after such a long time, as has been said, today if you will hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. And it's out of Proverbs. It comes out of Proverbs. Why do you think the writer of Hebrews said it 3 times? There must be emphasis there. There has to be. We have to be able to hear his voice. We have to develop a hearing that is central to that specific voice, like I had to in basic training, that single voice of my drill sergeant. You know, it is important for us to develop a fine tuning. I have in my new office at home, my new man cave, thanks to Pastor Joe, Pastor Rob, we worked on the floors last night. I invite you over just to see my cave. It's the coolest thing that ever was. Thanks, Pastor Joe. Really sort of getting in my head and staying there for a while, which was dangerous for him, I'm sure. But,
amen.
I've got this old radio. I wanted to, it's rustic in there. I've got the whole cave is rustic. So I bought this old radio from the 60s. It's an old AM radio clock radio, Philco. So I was messing around the other day and I plugged it in. It works. I don't know that I leave it on there or not in there. I'm not sure when. Sure, but it worked nice. And so then, you know how you do those, the old radio. For those of you who don't know that didn't grow up in the digital age, you turn it on and you have to turn it on and you go. And then you hit a station.
You hit a station. You're looking for that state. And I was so excited because I fine-tuned it. And see, that's what we got to do. We have to fine-tune ourselves to hear that voice all the time. And all of you hear the voice. I've said this time and time again, but I want to just emphasize it here. It's important that we continue to fine-tune, because even when I thought I had the station I wanted with that, see, it's really easy with digital radios. You just hit a number, poof, it pops up. You don't get nothing to the left, you don't get nothing to the right, you don't get nothing bleeding over. You just hit a number and that station pops up. No matter where you're at, if you hit that number, a station is going to pop up. That's how well FCC's got it now. But back in the day when it was just AM radio float across the airwaves, man, you get over here and all of a sudden this station from Podunk, Iowa would bleed over into your program. You have to get back on it, fine tune it a little bit more. That's what happens in our own lives. We start going along, we think we're listening to their voice correctly, and all of a sudden something starts to bleed over and you got to fine tune it again. You've got to get it back on where it needs to be so that there's no bleed over. 50 days. In 50 days, basic training meant, can't read my own handwriting. It meant to do one thing for me, prepare me for battle. That's what basic training was all about. It gave you a boldness. It gave you almost a feeling that you could do just about anything. I mean, right now, when Gabby's up here talking about tools and stuff, I'm thinking, yeah, some people like that little bitty saw that I bought. They call it a little baby saw. That baby saw works really good on tin. It doesn't bounce nowhere. It's got a blade on it. And I had to watch Rob yesterday and teach him how to use the thing to get his hand. I said, don't put your hand up there. Joe, slap you upside your head and put your hand up there. And it's like, but it's like, I'm learning. See, if you start learning, so there is a tool for everything. And I think now I can do anything. The bad part is, I have really shot myself in the foot. I know how to saw things. So now Debbie's got all these projects. And you've been skating on all these years, and now I know you can do stuff like that. So I'm really shot myself in the foot. So anyway, he says, if you get done basic training, you think you can do about anything. You are ready to take your next assignment on. That's when the deployment comes. See, there is a series of events in the military, just as it is in the kingdom. First off, is you got to be mobilized. That mobilization comes when you get saved. You're mobilized. When I signed the paper, raised my hand to go in the Army, I became a part of the United States Army when I was a senior in high school. I was, if they had wanted to, because I was under late entry, they could have pulled me out and taken me at that time had there been an act, because I was already signed up. So you're mobilized. The next thing is you have to be taught. That's what basic training is about. It's to teach you the basics of things. It's to teach you how to be a soldier. That's what church is about. It's a time of teaching. It's a time of getting yourself grounded. That's what Bible says. That's what going to a Monday night group once a month does for you. It teaches you how to speak. It teaches you how to think out loud and rationally in front of other people. It's a safe place. That's what Foundations is about. It's a safe place. That's what Thursday nights is about. It's a safe place to express yourself about the things of God. Then after you're being taught and the training, then you're equipped. You become equipped to do what you need to do. There's not one person in this room. I know I say this all the time. I'm just trying to repetition, and then one day you'll believe it. Because some of you don't believe it. Some of you don't believe that you're able. You're already equipped to do all you need to do. Some of you don't believe you're equipped to get up here and preach a message. You are already equipped. You're already. Bree can tell you it's not as hard as it looks. Sheila can tell you it's not as hard as it looks. The more and more we do that. And then the last thing is, and the five cycle thing is deployment. The time of the end of basic training deployment came. We had to go to our specific units. Deployment came to the disciples too. Look over at Luke 22. Luke chapter 22. It came for the disciples. Their time of deployment. We're going to look at verses 31 through 34. Now, this doesn't seem like a deployment verse, does it? But it is. Because listen to what he says. Jesus predicts Peter's denial. And the Lord says, Simon, Simon, indeed Satan has asked for you, and that he may sift you as wheat. But I have prayed for you, that your faith should not fail. So what is he doing there? Two things, right? He's saying, hey, Satan's got his eye on you.
He's got you got a target on your back. You know that every Christian has a target on their back from Satan? He wants, if he can, to cause you to do something that will affect a young one like this. Another young, doesn't have to be a child. He could be a young believer. He wants to take someone like a Gail and try to trip her up.
I'm just kidding, I just not you really is.
Trip her up. She gets out here and does something that she shouldn't do, and all of a sudden this young believer.
Well, Gail can do that, that's okay.
So the target's there. You say, but look what he says here. He says, he's asked to sift you. He wants to sift us. He wants to bring problems our way to where we feel like we can't handle them. We can't manage them. We can't do it. And you know what? Most problems we can't manage ourselves anyway as a believer. We should be trying to manage ourselves by ourselves. He goes on to say, but I pray for you and that your faith should not fail. What does he say to Peter? He says, you got faith. You got the ability to get through whatever comes your way. You've got the ability to walk where you need to walk and how you need to walk. He goes on to say this. And when you have returned,
somebody fell. Somebody stumbled. Somebody made a mistake.
He says, but when you return, so he's not leaving him down. He's not leaving him beat up. He's not leaving him behind. One of my favorite lines out of movie, sorry, is out of Horse Soldiers with John Wayne. They're getting ready to take off across this bridge, or they got some wounded in battle, and William Holden tells John Wayne, they were at odds with each other, tells John Wayne, he says, what do you do to the wounded? You just leave them to the clemency of the enemy? You realize that the enemy has no clemency. The enemy wants you destroyed utterly. He wants you totally destroyed utterly. So he's saying, look, so when you return, Jesus is saying, you're coming back. You made a mistake, but you're coming back. We need to let people know that have fallen away, fallen out, whatever, that there is a return. There is an ability to come back. There's an ability to be strong. We talked about it in Foundations this morning. I'm not sure how well this is or whether I'm on track, but it sounds to me good. You get out here, you get off track, and all of a sudden you say, there's only two things you have to say. I'm sorry. God restores you where you're supposed to be, where you should have been all along. And he rapidly brings it back forth. And I think Vince, we talked with Vince. Vince used his own life as an illustration. If you have... I don't think he's ever told your whole testimony. I don't think he has. But if he would ever tell you his whole testimony, you'd be amazed at what God has done with him because he has a willing heart and where he's at. And where he's at today. Where he started out as a teenager. Goes on back here and he goes, finish up, says, strengthen your brethren. So Peter's going to come out of this conflict stronger. He's going to come out of the battle stronger. He's going to come out of it more resolved because he's ready for deployment now. You know, and the deployment was here for them, for the disciples. It was no more sitting around the campfire talking about what Jesus did. When deployment hit, you're no longer sitting around. You're no longer a recruit. You're no longer the one that you have to put into action everything that you learned. That's where the disciples were at right now. He's saying, Peter, when you come back, strengthen your brothers. In other words, what I've taught you thus far, now you take with it and run with it. Now, if we look at where Peter ends up, turn him into Acts chapter 3. Peter is told you're going to fall. Peter is told, but when you come back, strengthen your brothers. In Acts chapter 3, that's exactly what Peter does. He comes back, Acts chapter 3, 1 through 10, I'm not going to read the whole thing. Peter and John went up together in the temple for an hour of prayer in the ninth hour, and a certain lame man from his mother's womb was carried, who had laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask for alms from those who entered. Peter and John come along this guy who's there every day. And they tell him, silver and gold I don't have, but what I do have, you get it. What they have is an understanding of how the Word of God changes your life. Well, they probably had money. It wasn't an issue there, but that's not what he needed. What he needed was a life change. Now, because he'd been begging alms all the time, every day. Everybody that passed by, not everybody, people passed by, they dropped money down there all the time. It didn't change his life. It didn't improve his life. He was still begging at the temple gate. But what they had for him was going to take him out of begging and into a powerful reality of a walk with God. Going to change his life drastically. I've heard people that are on disability. And they go to church and they love what's taught, this, that, and the other, and they want to believe in healing.
but they don't get healed because I can heal them. I lose my disability. This guy didn't do that.
They said to him, silver and gold have I none. That which I have, you get. And he got up and walked. He got up and left. It's no more sitting there. There's no more sitting around the campfire. They had to do it. They had to do it themselves. You know, B and I got talking about something the other night. About VBS. So it got me thinking. I was saying on this line, they were coming into a week of victory anyway. And so I got to thinking about some stuff. I went and looked in my closet. And, you know, when I first put on this uniform, it didn't jingle like that. But when I first put on this uniform, it didn't have all those stripes on it like that. It didn't have that patch on, which was combat. It didn't have that arm. Didn't fit like this. But I got it on.
Yeah.
Just can't close it. When I put this uniform on, just gives me more motivation to lose weight. Shows you the man I was at one time because it was big on what I wore.
Big on.
So that's where we got married. But you know, When I first put this on, I learned how to walk different. I learned how to talk different. When I first put that uniform on, I thought different. It made me think different. I responded different to things. I was ready for deployment because of that uniform. I was no longer a recruit. I no longer acted like one either. I was a soldier. I was ready. I was ready to go wherever they send me and do whatever they needed me to do. I was no longer a number like all the others, but I was an individual. I was a soldier. I was someone that I traveled. When I traveled in full uniform all the time because I was proud to wear that uniform. I was no longer just Bob out here on the side. I was either Private Martin, or I was Specialist Martin, I was Sergeant Martin. At one time, I was even going to be Lieutenant Martin. I decided to drop out of OCS. I didn't want to do it. I believed at that time, when I put that uniform on, when I first put the uniform, I believed in my government that had given me this suit. I believed in what my drill sergeant had told me I could do. I believed in my 50 days. Turn over to John chapter 14. John chapter 14. We're going to look at verses 8 through 14. Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, it is sufficient for us. And Jesus said to him, I've been with you. Have I been with you so long, and yet you know not me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father. So how can you say, show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father in me? And the words that I speak to you, I do not speak of my own authority, but of the Father who dwells in me also works. I believe me and that I am in the Father, and the Father in me, or else believe me for the sake of the works themselves. Verse 12 says, and most surely I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also. And greater works than these will he be able to do because I go to my Father. Whatever you ask in my name, I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. My drill sergeants could take that M16 and take it apart, put it all back together. My drill sergeants knew how to march in their sleep. My drill sergeants knew these. But when they said, if you'll do what I've taught you to do, if you'll do what I ask you to do these 50 days, I'll guarantee you at the end of the 50, you'll be able to do these and greater.
They were training us. I was in during Vietnam. They were training us to go to war.
I remember at a conversation with our drill sergeant in the week of graduation, and things sort of die off, you're just sort of tidying up things, you're doing this, and the drill sergeant just gets sort of real, they sit down, have a beer with you, and all that kind of stuff, you know. And we sit there and ask our drill sergeant. My drill sergeant actually became sergeant major of the Army. Sergeant major of all the Army. Sat down with us, Sergeant Collins sat down with us one time during that week, and we said, why do you guys like this? Why are you so mean all the time? We don't like being mean, but we can't get close to you because we don't know if we're sending you off to die. And we don't want to know that. We don't want to know here down the road that we trained you and we didn't train you good enough and you died in war because we didn't train you good enough. See, Jesus wasn't worried about Peter dying in war because he had trained him good enough. It was all about now that recruit Peter becoming who he could be, all that he could be, to steal an army phrase. Look at Acts chapter 5 now. Acts chapter 5, verses 12 through 16 says this. Through the hands of the apostles, many signs and wonders were done among the people. And they were all in one accord on Solomon's porch. But none of the rest dared to join them, but the people esteemed them highly. The disciples had become an extension of Jesus, just like he said they would. Because they had sat in his time. And at the end of their 50 days, they're now teaching at Solomon's porch. At the end of their 50 days, people are now sitting back going, whoa, look at what they're doing. What changed? What changed from Peter running and hiding? What changed from all of them scattering like the wind when Jesus was on the cross and being beaten? What changed? What changed? Nothing. Not one thing changed. The world was still the same. The world in which they live is still the same. The Pharisees and Sadducees were still there. The Roman emperor and all of them were still there. And both more empowered by what they had done to Jesus. Nothing had changed except this. The disciples had changed. They now believed. They believed in the government that sent them, that government of heaven. They believed that what they had been given by heaven was what they needed to do. They believed in their drill sergeant, Jesus. They believed in their 50 days. They believed they were ready. They believed they were prepared. You and I, beloved, have to believe that we're prepared. You and I, beloved, have to realize that we have everything we need now to do what we're supposed to do. Now, this jingles a little bit just for Christmas, was it? Debbie got all my miniature medals for me. Now, those are all cool, I think. People that have never been military, I mean, nothing to them. I mean, each one has a significance for me. But you know what? I'm not going to get medals when I get to heaven. I'm not getting anything like that to wear on my chest. I can't wear those on my chest because I can't put the stupid coat on. So, see, you can buy a bigger coat. I know, or lose the weight, really. But each one has a significance to me. You know what that we are going to get when we get to heaven? It's a crown. And every jewel in that crown will have significance. And someone will come up to you and go, you know what? You did this for me. Well, who are you? Who are you? Well, you didn't know me. My name's Joe. And I went to the base program in Morton. And I want to thank you for what you did. I want to thank you not just for me, but you see those two people over there? That's my mom and dad. They didn't know Jesus until I started going to Gail Westbrook's base program. And you know, my brothers and sisters, they're right over there. And my grandma, who didn't know, going down the road, got another crown. All of a sudden, hey, see that jewel in that crown, Bob? Yeah, that's mine. That's has to do with me. Well, who are you? Well, you're the one that, you wrote that little simple thing in a book that said something that caught my eye. And I started going to church. You see what I'm saying? Everything we do is for a reason. God wants us to pull us out. He wants our 50 days, at the end of our 50 days, He wants us to start excelling just like the disciples excelled. He wants us to step up and be like they did. Peter was a changed man. The world hadn't changed. Your world's not going to change tomorrow because you're here today.
Your world's not going to change next month because you went to, or next week because you went to the Victory Assembly all week long. It's not going to change your world in which you, the world in which you live, but you're going to change. And you're going to affect your world. The disciples affected their world to the point of thousands after thousands after thousands. And to this day, we're still celebrating their victories. To this day, we're still celebrating their faithfulness to the kingdom. To this day, you and I owe our whole existence and understanding of the word to those that wrote it, those that were afraid, those that the Satan tried to sift, those, but they got out of that position of the last one in the squad and started moving in the direction that God was calling them. I'm asking you, beloved, do you believe? Do you believe what God's done for you? Do you believe He has greater things for you? Do you believe? Do you truly believe? If you believe that if you stepped out here today and somebody's walking down the street, do you believe that you can talk to them about Jesus? That you can tell them a story about some old Chinese lady carrying two water. That went a whole different way than I thought it was. I was thinking she'd say, well, I needed one and a half. You served your purpose. But to line you, I knew your flaw and I had a purpose for it. Jesus knows our flaws. That's it. He knows our flaws. He has a purpose for our flaws. Are you able to do that? Do you believe you can do that? That's my. I want you thinking beyond the box you're living in right now. I want you thinking beyond what you're comfortable doing right now. Because I got to tell you right now, Rob Westbrook is not the same man he used to be. He's stepping out of that comfortable spot. He had to after doing two marriage classes with the two marriage seminars with Dale. But I mean, it's like, there's a difference. Bree and Aaron are different than what they thought they'd be when they first came to this church. When she was scoping that long-haired preacher out who was helping out at the base program one day. She's a different person today. Jeff and Sarah, everybody in here is stepping up. But are you, do you believe that you can do that out there? Because see, it's good to do it here. This is the training ground, guys. This is camp, training camp. This is where you get the equipping to do it. But where do you take it from here is the answer to the question. How much do you step out of the comfort zone? You know, I'm real comfortable. I shouldn't say it like that. I'm not comfortable every Sunday. I'm more comfortable every Sunday, getting more comfortable every Sunday. You guys make that happen. I'm more comfortable today than I've ever been before about going out and traveling, preaching in other churches. There was a time I don't know how to do that. But it makes me more comfortable. Debbie's up here beside me a lot of times. I get really, because my other half's there and I feel comfortable. But the thing is that I'm more comfortable. Why? Because I stepped out. It's that first stepping out. It's like, you know how uncomfortable it is to preach a sermon through an interpreter? The first time I did it, I thought, I'm going to get lost because I don't know where he's going. But by the time we got to Belgium and I taught a whole class on covenant through an interpreter, I was comfortable. I was too comfortable. I got too going too fast for him. But you have to do it first. You have to step out. How comfortable is it for Jeff to step out from being a geek to being in a normal audience? We teach him all the time, right? It takes you doing it. And every time I see somebody step up here to do what Rob did today, just freestyling, as it were, getting up here and teaching a simple story that I remember. I hope you do too, because it was a very poignant story. Are you willing to step out of your comfort zone? The disciples did, and that's what changed the world. Nothing in the world had changed until they stepped out of their comfort zone. They could have went back to being fishermen. They could have went back to the campfire and told great stories about what happened way back when Jesus was here. I'm tired of hearing stories about what it was like back in Azusa Street. I'm tired of hearing stories about how great it was. I don't want it to happen here. I'm tired of hearing stories about how great it's going overseas. But it's going to take us stepping out, doing what we're supposed to do. See, because Pastor Jim is going to be here this week. He's no different than the rest of us. I've been around him. He puts his pants on the same way you and I do. He drinks from the same kind of coffee you guys do. Well, not really. He drinks weird coffee. So, you know what I'm saying? He eats the same way we... No, not all the time. He's on his diet again. So. But he does. He's no different than us.
But God's using him in another way. Why? Because he decided to step out and say, I believe. I believe. I believe. Do we believe? We have to. We don't do it for our own glory. We don't do it for our own benefit. We don't do it because we want our church to grow bigger. We don't do it because we want the finances to get better. We don't do it for, we do it for one reason only. For our country. Our kingdom. The kingdom of heaven. That's why we have to step out of our comfort zone. That's why we have to be about the Father's business. That's why we have to do, get into areas and just do things different than we've ever done before. Because we believe in all what they just sang about. We believe in all of that. And when we believe in all that, we've got to share that. That's what the disciples really found out, that they believed. It wasn't just something that had happened. They believed in all of it. And they couldn't hold it in. They couldn't hold it in at all. Amen? Father, we thank you, Lord, that we do believe. I ask you, Father, that you grab a hold of each of us. And you show us in a whole new way our purpose. Not just the purpose we're living in today, but the purpose for us in the future. The purpose that you've already outlined in your heaven. The purpose that you've already driven an account for us. Thank you for that, Father. Thank you that you have placed yourself today where we're supposed to be at tomorrow. And I thank you for that. Now take us, each one of us, into our tomorrows with a strength and understanding that you've already gone there. You've already prepared the way. And that we can be all we want to be simply because we believe.